Hey folks, Dr. Mike here for Renaissance Periodization Muscle Gain Dieting Made Simple, video number 3, hitting the right macros. So for videos 1 and 2, we learned how to standardize and count our intake as far as macros are concerned. And we also learned what kind of foods we should be eating more of that are healthier and that support muscle growth the best. Now, we talked about all this without ever talking about macros. So you could hypothetically have a situation where you're eating like, 200-pound male, and you're eating like 50 grams of protein a day, 250 fats, and 150 carbs, and you're sort of gaining weight slowly or just maintaining, and all the ratios are wrong. So we do have to talk about what macro splits, macro ratios are best for muscle gain in order to get you your absolute best. The way I've sort of like to do this is first we get you to count stuff, then we get you to eat healthy foods, then we get you to actually hit certain macro targets. If you don't learn how to count stuff, hitting macro targets is almost impossible because you don't know how to count macros. If you start trying to hit macro targets, but you don't know how to eat healthy foods first, your diet is going to be real weird. It's going to be like, oh, I had a protein shake and 2 Pop-Tarts and a Pixie Stick and like a scoop of like, I can't believe it's not butter. And it's like, good God. All right, somebody has to teach you how to actually eat food. So first you learn how to count stuff, then you learn how to eat healthy food. Then you start to wiggle in those healthy foods into the macros that are better for muscle gain. And muscle gain needs a few things to happen right, and it needs the macros to reflect that. We have to have protein to build muscle. There's a certain minimum amount you need in which you can really check plus that column of protein to make sure it's not limiting your gains, right? Carbs, you need to provide mental and physical energy, and also they probably have a role over time, over the long term, of actually stimulating anabolism through a variety of pathways, one of which is insulin, another one which is glycogen. Just really quick, insulin tends to be an anabolic hormone. It's not anabolic in any rapid sense, but over a long term, if you have pretty high exposure to insulin, days and weeks and months, through high carbohydrate eating, especially around a workout window, that tends to promote, probably saves muscle and muscle loss periods really well, and probably has a small advantage in even just gaining you more muscle overall, right? And in addition to that, glycogen, if your body is storing a lot of carbs in the muscle, which is what glycogen is, if your body detects that you have a lot of glycogen, it's pretty full, it actually allows the muscle growth processes to occur at a really high rate. If your body detects that you have very little glycogen, then it actually doesn't potentiate your muscle growth processes hardly at all and can downregulate them a little bit. So you want plenty of glycogen, plenty of carbohydrates to fuel that glycogen and insulin in order to get your best possible outcomes with mass gaining, which is probably one of the reasons why high carb diets are almost universal for the world's biggest bodybuilders. It's a thing almost everyone does. Lastly, we want some fats to keep hormonal health up and keep health metrics up because fats are indispensable. And of course, their use in a fat loss diet is those two things, but in a muscle gain diet, they also help to boost calories. Like if you want like a diet which has like 10 grams of fat per day and you want to gain muscle off of that and gain weight, good God, you are going to have to eat so much protein and carbohydrate. You're going to be pooping, I don't know what, at that point, some mixture of, I'm not going to get into it. YouTube algorithm is going to flag me for what I was about to say. But in any case, fats are easy to eat. They're fun to eat. And they're actually quite cheap compared to the other macros. They're pretty healthy. So we're going to use fats not just for those check marks of health and hormonal stuff, but also to potentially raise our intake if we just can't eat any more protein and carbohydrate, especially carbohydrate, because protein is going to be pegged at a pretty reasonable number the whole time. So what are these macro amounts that we want you guys to hit? Protein intake, something like 1 gram per pound per day. So if you're 200 pounds, you eat roughly 200 grams of protein is really pretty close to ideal for folks that are looking to put on muscle. Let me make this a little bit more complex, even though it's made simple. I think I owe it to you guys to make it a little bit more sciencey and put in some rationalization here, or justification. Rationalization is when you excuse yourself. So can you get away with eating less protein and still gain muscle? Yes. But not for a very high degree of certainty. You can be like 90% sure you're getting all your protein if you eat like 0.8 grams per pound per day. So it's like if you're 200 pounds, you eat 160 grams of protein per day, there's a very, very good chance you're getting enough protein. But it's not like it's 90%. It's not 100% or it's not 99. That's a pretty big difference. I think if you could just eat 40 grams more protein per day, you'd be happy to know that you really sort of filled the gaps. Now, here's the thing. Is there a chance that you can get more benefit eating more than a gram of protein per pound a day. Like if you eat 200 grams being 200 pounds, what if you eat 220, 250, 280, 300? Can there be a benefit? There might be. The mechanisms with that are not very well fleshed out or even very well hypothesized. Like we don't even know why that would happen. We know a lot of really good bodybuilders do it. They also do a lot of dumb shit, doesn't make any sense, and end up, you know, over the decades doing less of that dumb shit. You don't want to be the person sort of holding the shitty end of the stick and still eating 400 grams of protein for no reason in 10 years whenever IFBB Pro stops doing that. So is there a chance that there's some marginal benefit there? Yes, but that chance is very, very small. Tons and tons of studies have been done in a gram per pound. Like the top end of what humans can for sure use for anabolism is just right here. And a gram per pound is right over here. And up here beyond that is like, I don't know, maybe for some weird reason you'd need more, but it really strains the imagination. So if you do a gram per pound, it's like, I guess the best way to explain it is like, you're really just covering all the reasonable bases you possibly could. Right? This is the dumbest analogy I'll ever make. Ooh, no, I'll make stupider ones later. Probably I have made dumber ones before. It's like if you're like getting the military to put a division down in like a crazy planet that still has dinosaurs from our past history, like, do you need to bring a bunch of nukes? Probably not. They're dinosaurs, for the love of God. They're made of meat, okay? Regular conventional weapons will do. But do you bring like a heavy machine gun and just assume you're going to plow down 3 T-Rexes in a row and not jam? I don't know. I want like a big gun. But if you have like a couple 155 millimeter howitzers with you, or a couple of, you know, M1, A2, or A3 platforms with, you know, 120 millimeter gun, you know, pretty much you're going to kill all the dinosaurs. Unless some crazy shit comes out of nowhere, which we've never even found in the fossil record, you're good, right? So eating 400 grams of protein per day when you weigh 200 is like sort of the analogy there is like bringing like 10 nukes to dinosaur planet. Overkill. Okay. And there's definitely a cost, physical cost. There's a diarrhea cost to that. As you eat that much protein, your poop starts to look interesting. And there's just no clear benefit. Now, will you always need a 120 millimeter cannon to kill a T-Rex and some stegosaurs or whatever trying to kill you? There's zombie dinosaurs, of course. No, a 50 cal might do just fine. But maybe it jams and maybe the dinosaur's still running at you. Maybe there's 3 of them and you killed one and 2 you barely killed and the third one eats you out of your Jeep or whatever. So if you have tank cannons, it's a little bit overkill, just a little, but it's a really good insurance policy. Weirdest tangent analogy maybe ever made. I'm sure you guys will get a kick out of it. And if you don't, just tell me in the comments. You suck. Shut up. Stop these stupid analogies. In any case, that's protein. Really straightforward. So if you weigh 150 pounds, you're eating like 150 grams of protein per day. Pretty straightforward. Fat intake. Very similar to a fat loss dieting series. Anywhere between 0.3 and 0.5 grams per day is a really good range. You know, if you eat much more than 0.5 grams per day, sometimes you can't get enough carbohydrates in to fuel the training and insulin and glycogen pathways. So eating too much fat has some downsides unless your calories are so high that the carbs are high anyway and you could just eat more fat, right? But generally 0.3 to 0.5 is where we want most folks to be. And on a massing phase closer to 0.5, it lets you eat tastier foods and so on and so forth. Definitely no lower than 0.3, okay? For sure. On a massing phase, because then your hormonal levels might be so off that your testosterone may be so low that you don't gain a whole lot of muscle anyway and you feel like shit and all that. So 150 pound person in that example, we eat somewhere between 45 grams of fat per day on the very low end, probably more like 75 grams of fat. And look, if you eat up to 100 in that example, you're totally cool as long as you're getting plenty of carbs. How do you determine carbs? Well, you count your protein calories, you count your fat calories, you add them together. Whatever's left of the daily calories that you have is going to be coming from carbs. Now, daily calories are, you know, pretty straightforwardly determined. We'll talk about later how we're altering them, but it's just going to be what you're currently eating from your diet. I eat this much. We're going to talk about later how to manage those calories and change them to make sure you keep gaining, but whatever calories you're at now, subtract protein, subtract fats, whatever's left, that's going to be carbs. Real straightforward. What we don't want you to do is, first of all, if you're eating so few calories that you're down to like, for any regular size individual, less than 100 grams of carbs, you're not eating enough calories, almost certainly. And if you're eating so much protein and so much fat that's way out of these recommendations and you're eating less than 100 grams of carbs, bad news. For most people, especially adult males, we're talking 200 grams of carbs plus. Okay, 200 to 400 to 600 and even to 800 in some cases, all right? So carbs, grams of carbs are in the hundreds, usually multiple hundreds. And if it's less than that, you get into a pinch that's not necessarily ideal. Right? So that's what we're doing as far as macro amounts. A couple of pointers there to make sure we're all on the same page. As long as you get your protein in, and you go between 0.3 and 0.5, and 0.5 is really kind of stingy. You can go up to 0.75, no problem. You can have whatever ratio of carbs to fats you like. And it's really a lot of down to personal preference, because in the literature on the subject and even in the theoretical stuff, it just, as long as your carbs are a minimum of this, and as long as your fats are a minimum of that, and carbs are a minimum of, like, you get really good pumps and you feel a lot of training energy, and different people respond differently to different carbs, you're good to go, right? And here's a really simple experiment you can do with yourself. Whatever carbs you're eating now, wherever stage in this process you're in, let's say you're mass gaining, you're eating a certain amount of fats and a certain amount of carbs, and you think to yourself, shit, am I not eating enough carbs and eating too many fats? Take your fats and push them down to, like, between 0.3 and 0.5 per day. Just do that, okay, somewhere between those two. And then take your carbs and fill in what the calories you got out of that, right? You're going to add, you might add like 100 or 200 grams of carbs doing that, depending on how your fats were. If within a few days you get much better pumps and your training energy is kind of nuts and you're recovering faster, you did the right thing. You were definitely not having enough carbs and concomitantly too many fats. If after a few days, if after a week, nothing's changed with your pumps that you can reasonably attest to, nothing's changed with your training energy, your recovery's the same, that earlier carb amount was fine. So is this one. Just eat how you like. A lot of times, more fats let you eat more regular foods that are enjoyable. For example, if you're massing and you go to Chipotle with your friends because you want bloody diarrhea or whatever the hell Chipotle gives you from that one South Park episode maybe 15 years ago, holy shit, I'm dating myself. You can get a burrito that fits your macros if you're really low fat and high carb, but they're like, yeah, beans, you're like, yeah, rice, you're like, yeah, like cheese, you're like, no, sour cream, no, guac, no. They're like, why are you here? And I don't know, it's definitely not to have fun. So it limits you if you're doing very high carb, very low fat. If you're doing higher fat, then you get to put a lot of the fun stuff in your burrito. You gain the same amount of weight. And within a big margin, it doesn't really affect your body composition differently. It's like if you eat plenty of fats, but you eat enough carbs and enough protein, you're not going to get fatter, versus if you eat tons of carbs and very little fat and still the same amount of protein, you're not going to gain any more muscle or any more fat. And one of the others, if the calories are the same, it's very similar as long as you're getting enough carbs and enough fats to meet minimum levels. So give that some thought. Do whatever you like. Are there theoretical reasons why slightly more carbs and less fats could potentiate bigger gains, especially in folks using special sports supplements? Yes. But if you're not using those, really don't worry about it. And theoretical stuff is really a better term for that, is hypothetical. If it's hypothetical, there may be some advantages, but I can almost guarantee you, and I'm the person, myself and my coach, Broderick Chavez, we're the people that really explain that and thread that out and put it out into the ether, as he would say. We're not even so confident that it's 100% sure, but we are very confident that if it does increase anabolism, muscle gain, to do really high carb, really low fat, it's a teeny tiny, tiny little increase. And maybe something you can do when you're getting later into the tail end of your career and you really want to optimize, right? So as long as your daily calories are the same, making sure you're getting really good pumps, really good training energy, really good recovery, that's how you kind of determine your carb to fat balance. And that's it, right? And that's it. It doesn't get much more complicated than that. Now, at this point in the video series, we have the right macros from eating the right food, which is really, really good. And of course, we're tracking all that. The next step, we're going to talk about meal frequency and meal timing and all that stuff, choosing the meal size, choosing the meal number, not just to get the best results, but also stuff that's realistic and makes you not throw up a lot during workouts. See you next week for that next video.